because it's my idea of a film, which, right, so it's called Just a Story, and I've decided to do it with a question mark because it sparks interest in what's just a story. So when you've got on like YouTube and stuff, you've got all the suggested videos, the ones with the more of the statements and the short film titles look more appealing than the ones of like the long ones. So like, I've watched Plastic, and I didn't have a clue what Plastic and Fear is, and like the film is actually really clever, and so it, like, it sparks interest and gets you, it gets you like more appeal to it. Also, the title as well. It's obviously it becomes clear later on why it's called Just a Story, but it seems to already have like an art appeal to it. No one like. The pitch, the short film to have like an art appeal. So, okay, so just as a brief summary, basically, in the short, the girl has been given a book that's been, and she's also been told never to give up on something that you believe in. So that's what I want my moral of the story to be. And she constantly reads the book. When she's got the book, good things from like fairy tales subtly happen in her life. And then when the book gets taken away, like the bad things in fairy tales like suddenly happen in her life. So it's like you're creating sort of like a fairy tale story with elements of other fairy tales in. But it's like a real life situation. So there's like four parts to the film. So the first part, it starts with an establishing shot of a girl in a bedroom. So like she'd be like lying in bed with the nightlight on, and she'd be reading the book, and that's when the voiceover starts, and it'll basically explain how she got the book through being passed down through generations of like her parents, and something that her mum gave to her and she died, and then it also she also explains how she's been left with a stepmother, which is like a fairy tale convention, after her father's died too. And he was one I told her never to give up on something that she believes in. So she then puts the book down and like, she settles into bed and she turns the nightlight off. And then there'll be like another bit of voiceover in like, the darkness that basically says, but even in all perfect fairy tales, nothing is as it seems. And then it'll wake, like the light will come back on again as if she looks uncomfortable. And she'll get out of bed. She'll lift up the mattress and she'll find like a marble or like a small object, so, like Princess and the Pea. And then it moves on to the next scene. So she lifts up the mattress, find a marble and resemble Princess and the Pea. So the next scene is like main like a quick montage of like different scenes. So it'll show her leaving the house with the book in her arms and then walking down the street with the book in her arms at the train station, she'll be reading the book. On the train, she'll be reading the book. In a coffee shop, she'll be reading the book. So you basically get the idea that this book is everything. Walking in the high street, and then she'll get to like a wish, like a fainting, and she'll be sat there reading the book. And then, like when she's finished reading the book, she'll read. She'll read. So like, it's like as if she's reading in her head. It comes across like a monologue. As if she's reading from the book itself, so it would be a clip like just carry on believing and the dream that you wish will come true, and then she'll throw like a penny into the fountain and make a wish. Then she'll get a text from her stepmother asking her to go and put flowers on father's grave for her. But like last year when we did like the social media and stuff, like we did a screen capture of it, and obviously that's a bit more difficult to do when we do it on like a phone. So I was thinking, if we did something like that, we could do it like they do on Hollyoaks, the way that they do their text messages. So this is how they do their text messages, and it also looks quite artistic in itself as well. So it just comes up on screen. So it just comes up on the screen like that. it just come up on the screen like that, so it's, you don't necessarily have to worry about it, it just come up as a title. And it adds to like, the more artistic feel of the whole piece itself. So the next scene, there'll be like a change of day, so you know that time has passed and she may have gone to the grave, she might have put the flowers in, but you don't necessarily have to show that. So she'll be walking down like a darkened street, probably not as dark as that, but she'll be walking down like a darkened street, so she looks vulnerable and like on her own and stuff. And she'll get stopped and like someone'll start talking to her, like trying to be friendly to her, and obviously you don't want to talk to strangers. And so he ends up mugging her, and as she runs off, the shoe will come off, like in Cinderella, and the guy talking to her will resemble like a wolf in Little Red Riding Hood. And then the next scene is her waking up in the morning, and basically she turns to find that her shoe and the book is by her bed, because she's been mugged, so obviously the book's been taken off her. So she finds that the book and the shoe are by her bed, and she sees like this girl come into her room, and basically she explains like who she is and the fact that she'd seen her while she being mugged, and decides to come return the book and return the shoe. She followed her home. Okay, so then the next scene is basically her doing, at the start when we had her going to the train station and stuff, it'd basically be like near enough a repeat of that, but of course she'd be like in different clothes because it'd be like a different day and a different time and stuff. But this time she'd be reading at the train station, reading on the train, and then she'll accidentally leave the book on the train. So when she comes off, she'll be all panicked and all stressed because she hasn't got a book again. She's worried what's happened to it. But then some stranger will stop her with the book, and it turns out to be a guy. And he will basically give her like his number as well for her troubles. So then it goes on again, and she's getting ready, obviously, to go out or something. And you don't really know what she's getting ready for, why she's dressing up nicely. And then like, there'll be a knock on the door, and it'll be the guy from the train station. And so basically she's going from like a geek kind of look to being like a princess, but I'll explain that more in a minute. And so it's more like the Ugly Duckling and Cinderella, and then it'll end there. Okay? So this would be the protagonist, which is the main girl in the whole film itself. And her name would be Bryony James, and she'd be about 18 years old and from like around like the Birmingham area. And I wanted to have like a geek look to her, so she's not, because obviously this is like quite fairy tales, I don't want her to look like a princess. And so she'd have like her hair tied back, she'd have like the glasses, she'd have like plain clothes, she'd be like brunette instead of like the typical pretty blonde. And she'd just have like a general geek look about her. And then the other characters, so we'd have Tom, who is the guy who'd stop her after the train station. So he's like the sort of prince in the whole situation. The guy in the street who like mugs her, so he's kind of like the wolf. And then the girl who brings her back the book and the shoe, it's kind of like a fairy godmother who's like saving her. So the target audience for just the story would be 16 to 24 year olds, because I think because of it being such like a fairy tale nature and having such young characters, it'd have quite a small target audience. It'd also have like quite a niche target audience too, since it is quite arty and quite creative, and some people it just wouldn't appeal to some people because they just wouldn't, not that they wouldn't get it, they just wouldn't like it in the sense of what it's like. It mostly be females as well, but obviously there would be some males who would be appealed to it. So the conventions of short films is that they usually have a low budget, small amount of characters, usually about two or three. It's more of like a piece of art than just like a story, like a modern natural story. Usually follows Todorov's theory. Usually has a twist. It's usually relatable as well to people, so it like appeals to people because it's relatable. It's quite short in length, it's about 5-10 minutes. And then the audience is quite niche and quite small to the creative art type of people. This short film would conform to these conventions by having the small budget. There's not a lot that you'd need within it. It would be more of a piece of art because it's more creative and more of a big like a storyline. It appeals to a niche audience, like the artistic characters. The characters, there are not many main characters at all. Really, there's only one main character. It'd be 5 minutes, obviously. And there is like a slight twist in it when she has the book taken off her. It also does follow Todorov's theory. So like, everything's fine at the start. Everything is as it should be when she gets on the train and stuff. And then when she gets mugged, that's the disruption. The recognition that the order's been that the disorder's occurred is the fact that she's been running home, like obviously upset. Then when Anna came in, the attempt to repair the damage is when she gets given the book and gets given the shoe back. And then the fact that she goes back on the train and does what she did at the start is the restoration of a new equilibrium. But it also does subvert some of the conventions. So like, the situation, it's not exactly something you can relate to. Like, no one really gets on a train, goes to coffee shops, goes to a fainting, and then gets a text to come home. That just doesn't really happen. And then like the characters as well. Even though there's only really one main character, there's four characters in all. And usually that's quite unusual for like a short, because they like to stick to like two or three. It also challenges Todorov's theory too, because even though you've got the main ones I've just stated, it also kind of comes back on itself and does it again. So like another disruption of when she leaves the book on the train, and then the attempt to repair the damage is obviously Tom giving her his number to try and look after and make sure she's okay, and then the restoration is when he's obviously going to take her out on a date or something. Any questions?
Will the shots be like quick paced, because it just seemed like it would be 5 minutes.
It seems like a long film, but when it comes to like the montage and stuff, that section, that's going to be quite fast paced, and then the bit after where she's walking down like dark street, that's not going to be that long, because if you think about like a real mugging, they don't mess about, it's going to be quite quick. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot more of a shock as well to the audience. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do you have any locations in mind?
I do, yeah. The bedroom could be pretty much any bedroom, as long as it looks feminine, and it's got like the bed, like bedside table and the lamp. I mean, look, I have that in my room, so it literally anything could be used. And then the train station could be Landywood, Cannock. And you've got local ones, and then obviously you're on the train, so you can get quite a lot of filming done. If like you went to like to Birmingham, you get quite a lot of filming done on the train, so you wouldn't really have to worry about that too much. And then like the high street and the fainting, there's like one in Birmingham, so you can film quite a lot there. It's quite a big open space, and it looks, because obviously you don't really have to hire extras and something, because they're already like about. And then when she's walking down like a dark street, down like my street, there's like a little alley before like Asda, and it's quiet constantly. And that really does look effective. And then, yeah, so that's all the locations.
Do you want water to be in the fountain?
Water?
Yeah.
Why? Because there's no water in
there. There's no water in there.
I know. It wouldn't really matter that much, because it'd be difficult to film something going into water. So if it just looked like a fainting, because there's two, isn't it? You've got the main one and you've got the one over the side. Both of them, I was in Birmingham the other day, and if you stand back, you don't really see what's in it. If she just like threw it in, it wouldn't matter so much in these technically.
The only thing that I think will be difficult to film is the train one, because there's just everyday people on there. You don't know if they want to be in, you could catch them. And because it would just be difficult to film, because you can't really set up a tripod in the middle of a... That's the only thing that you'd have to worry about.
Well, I was thinking, instead of like filming like the whole train, just filming, literally. So say, look, she's sat down.
Sort of like what Ryan and that did.
Like, John, they had like the window, and then like her next to the window, and literally film it like in that corner, so you wouldn't see anybody else.
You just have to go off peak on a day when, you know, we don't want to say off day closing, don't have that anymore, do you?
But there'd be no no sound or anything, because most of it would be music and voiceover. So obviously she's constantly reading, so it will be as if she's reading and read.
Yeah.
Any other questions? Yes.
You said your target audience is 16 to 24. Do you think it should be younger, because it's quite an unbelievable story though?
I did think about this as like fairy tales and young people, but at the same time, younger people wouldn't really, not that they wouldn't like appreciate it, they wouldn't really get how it's kind of like fairy tale, if you get what I mean.
Like, they wouldn't make the connection.
They wouldn't make the connection, no. Like, it'd be a lot more difficult, because obviously, for younger people, it needs to be kind of portrayed. And that's where I thought it was quite artistic and quite like creative and stuff. So, yeah.
Do you know how you said it was going to appeal to both male and female? How are you planning on making it appeal to males?
I said mostly female, because you can't really account for like the other type of males, so I don't really know what they'd be appealed to or not. So obviously you have the more feminine males as well that may like you or may not. Any more questions?
I think the question I had, I think you've kind of answered, you want your audience to be aware that it's linked to various fairy tales. I think you've got to be careful about being too subtle about that.
Yeah.
So when the person got mugged by the wolf, you know, you said there'd be some dialogue, friendly dialogue before he mugs that. I think, you know, if that dialogue was something like, "My, what a nice book you have," and then he mugs that, it makes those links more explicit.
Yeah.
There's a danger that if the audience don't get those links, it loses a lot of its appeal. So I don't know if you have to be as quiet as unsubtle as I just was, but you need to make sure that those messages are clear.
I was actually going to read the books and see like what, and watch the films and see what I can put into like the dialogue and stuff, but I didn't want to put like a script or whatever.
No. Okay. Any other questions? Can I round of applause?